So in this video, me and my lovely lab assistant did the work on the capstone or target lab for this project. And one reason we call this the capstone lab is that it puts together a lot of different ideas. We have to look at an oxidation reduction reaction using an acid and a metal to generate a gas. That means it's going to involve stoichiometry because we want to predict the amount of gas that we're going to make. But predicting the amount of gas means we're actually going to be predicting the volume of the gas that's produced because it's very difficult to get the mass of a gas. And that means we will need the ideal gas law, Pabnert, and we'll end up needing Dalton's law of partial pressures because of the way that we're collecting the gas. So this lab puts together a number of pieces in the gas law unit. So we are going to use this reaction of magnesium metal and hydrochloric acid to generate some hydrogen gas. And we're going to compare the amount of hydrogen gas we generate with what we theoretically should have made. That means we're going to need to know exactly how much magnesium we started with. And I have taken this piece of magnesium, I polished it with some steel wool to get any fingerprints or tarnish magnesium oxide off of it as much as I could. And then I went ahead and put that carefully on our milligram balance. The milligram mass of this is 0.043 grams or 43 milligrams. So now we know the reaction that we're going to be using, which is again on the screen. We're going to be using solid magnesium metal and aqueous hydrochloric acid to produce some H2 gas. This is the balanced chemical equation. So we can use the BCE to show that 1 millimole of magnesium should produce 1 millimole of hydrogen gas. You notice we're working in millimoles, which means all the way along here we'll be working in milligrams, millimoles, milliliters. And that will make it easier for us because that's already how the equipment is graduated. So now we know that we had 43 milligrams of magnesium, so we have the number to put into our equation and convert into millimoles. Then we use the BCE to predict the millimoles of hydrogen gas that will be made. And you're going to need that number, so I would go ahead and do that in your lab notebook now. Using 43 milligrams of magnesium, figure out how many millimoles of hydrogen gas you should produce. So in order to do this reaction, I need to be able to keep this in the measuring device. So I made a little cage out of some copper wire because copper does not react with hydrochloric acid and the magnesium will. And you can see the magnesium strip, I've just bent it over into a little U shape. And the magnesium strip is stuck up into the cage. Here, this is a eudiometer. It's a long glass tube. And if you look at it, you'll see that it is gradated in milliliters here. And at the moment, since we haven't started the experiment, it's upside down for us. But when we start the experiment, we'll be able to see the numbers counting from the top. So here's our setup. We have the eudiometer in a clamp so that it's standing upright right now. And we've measured out 12 milliliters of the hydrochloric acid in this graduated cylinder. And we're going to go ahead and pour that into the top of the tube carefully, watching out for fingers. So you can see now that the hydrochloric acid is in the bottom of the eudiometer. We're now filling the rest of the eudiometer tube with some distilled water. And since hydrochloric acid is actually a more dense solution than plain water, The hydrochloric acid is really going to remain down at the bottom of the tube while the top is getting filled with water. That's going to keep our hands safe when we do the rest of this experiment. This is a gas law experiment. We know we are going to have to be sure we know what the temperature and pressure are in the room. So I hooked up a LabQuest to a temperature probe and a pressure probe. So we have our room temperature and room pressure. So our temperature here is 25 degrees Celsius, or 298 degrees Kelvin, of course. And our room pressure is 97.87 kPa. So now we have the strip of magnesium in the copper cage. You can see the eudiometer is full pretty much to the top. So we're going to, as quickly as possible, insert the stopper, plug the hole up, and invert the entire thing into a water bath. In there, and so now we're flipping the whole thing over, inserting it into the water bath. Now you've seen our experimental setup, and you can see that it looks essentially just like the picture here. We have the eudiometer, which is like a long test tube that's graduated so we can measure the volume. We have the magnesium down in our little cage, the one-hole rubber stopper. We've inverted it into a water bath. And now we're going to do this reaction and collect the hydrogen gas produced. The hydrogen gas that's produced is going to bubble up to the top and push out the water, which is great because the water then is going to capture that gas so we can measure it. But it does give us a bit of a problem because no matter how much I wish it didn't, water will evaporate a little bit in that space also. So the gas that's forming at the top of the tube will not just be hydrogen gas. It will also have some water vapor. That's called the vapor pressure, the little bit of water that evaporates anytime you have liquid water around. And luckily, this is something that's been studied many, many times. And there are tables which will allow us to look up the amount of water vapor pressure we should see in the tube given the temperature. You can see the magnesium strip here is starting to react with the hydrochloric acid. As you can see, bubbles of hydrogen are starting to form. This took a minute or two after we inverted this, so because the hydrochloric acid solution had to work its way down. You can see this reaction is still proceeding and the gas has displaced more of the water now. Still see lots of bubbles being formed all the way down to our strip, still bubbling away. So now you've seen the reaction starting and happening. Before we go any further in this video, we have to stop and predict the amount of hydrogen gas, the volume of hydrogen gas that we're going to produce. And we can use the ideal gas law for that because we now know the number of millimoles. We calculated that earlier. We have the temperature, which we got off our lab quest. We have R, of course, the gas law constant, which we're going to use in kilopascals. And we have the pressure, kind of, because we need to think about the pressure inside the tube. Some of the molecules are hydrogen, of course, but some of those molecules, some of the pressure is coming from water vapor, the vapor pressure of water. So we have to find the pressure of the hydrogen gas by itself. We cannot just use the total pressure or the atmospheric pressure that I read off of the LabQuest because That pressure, when we equalize it with the tube, will be the total pressure, the hydrogen gas and the water. Well, the good news is we know the temperature. So from a table, we can get the vapor pressure of water in the tube. And I looked this up at 25 degrees, the vapor pressure of water is 3.17 kPa. So the total pressure will be the atmospheric pressure in the room. Now we know the vapor pressure of water, 3.17 kPa. So how can we use this information to find the pressure of the hydrogen gas by itself? Well, that's fairly simple. Dalton's law says the total pressure is the sum of all the partial pressures. So the pressure total is equal to the pressure of H2O, which we know from our table here is 3.17 kPa, plus the pressure of the hydrogen gas. So you can use that equation to find the pressure of hydrogen gas by itself. And then you'll put that into PV equals nRT and predict the volume. So you need to get a predicted number. Put that in your lab notebook, put a little box around it, because you will need that later. So you can see here now the strip is so small that it's actually managed to get loose of the cage and is now floating at the top of the water and the hydrochloric acid solution. So we're going to have to watch that and make sure that it's all gone before we decide that we've finished our reaction. Now that everything is done, it would be very tempting to try to take a measurement right now, but we have a problem. The pressure in the room and the pressure in the tube are not the same. I can tell they're not the same because there must be enough pressure pushing on the water outside of the tube in this beaker that it's actually pushing water up into the tube to the tune of quite a few milliliters. So the pressure outside of the tube must be quite a bit greater than the pressure in the tube. Now, as I mentioned, the one thing we do also need to consider is the fact that we do need to make sure that the pressure inside of the tube is the same as the pressure in the room, the atmospheric pressure, so that we can accurately calculate the pressure. Because I can't directly stick a pressure probe into the eudiometer, it's glass. It would break. Then all my gas would take off. So looking at this example, this is actually a very simple barometer that you might remember. One of the pressure units we've talked about occasionally is millimeters of mercury, because a lot of old barometers were made out of mercury. And you would measure the height that the mercury reached in the tube in millimeters, hence the pressure unit millimeters of mercury. In this case, I know that the pressure outside of the tube is higher than the pressure in the space above the column, because the air outside is pushing so hard on the liquid that it's able to push it up and hold it up inside of the tube. Essentially, it's very similar to how a straw works. When you suck on a straw, you create a low pressure at the top of the straw, and the air outside pushes on the liquid and pushes the liquid up into the straw, because now the pressure outside of the straw is greater than the pressure inside of the straw. So we will need to make sure that the water levels inside and outside of the tube are going to have to be the same. If they're the same, then we know that the pressure pushing on the outside water is the same as the pressure pushing from the inside, and therefore the pressure in the tube is the same as the atmospheric pressure. So right now, I have my hand here. I'm trying to make sure that nothing gets out. You see here now, I have transferred this here. And you can see it's still taller than the tube. But as I go down here, I can actually cause the water level, the volume to change. You see, it goes up and down as I pull in and out of the tube. Now this is graduated to tenths of a milliliter, so I'm going to get at least 2 decimal places of volume. For example, if I measured it up here, admittedly it might be easier to see, I would actually read that as 45.2 or 45.3 milliliters. As I get closer and closer, that's clearly actually not going to be as big as 45. So I'm going to try and get this as close to right exactly level as I possibly can and try and measure this. And so putting that right there, that looks like 44.8. It's like really probably 44.80 on the nose milliliters of gas has been produced. And you can see that's right there at the surface of the water. So that tells me that the room pressure and the pressure inside the tube should be exactly the same. So the last thing we want on this lab is the percent error. And that's a formula we went over very early in the year. In this case, we're going to take our predicted value, the number that we got from using the ideal gas law, and our temperature, our corrected pressure, and our millimoles that we got from the stoichiometry. And we're going to compare that to the 44.8 milliliters that I actually measured when the pressure was equalized in the tube and the graduated cylinder. So you are going to need that predicted value. You're going to compare it to the actual value, 44.8, and calculate the percent error. So we have a lab report sheet for this that you can follow through. You will show the calculations as your instructor requires you to do, and you will calculate the percent error for the experiment that you saw in the video.